Thank you, sir. Yeah, Dr. Karthik Easton. He's graduated from Tanjore Medical College in 1996 and finished his post-graduation from Government Medical College, Nagpur in 2000. He has got his intervention cardiology training in Sri Satya Sai Institute, Puttaparthi from 2001 to 2004. After a few years of intervention cardiology practice, he underwent special training in cardiac arrhythmia management from Sri Jayadeva Institute of Cardiology, Bangalore. He received fellowship in complex arrhythmia management from Shanghai Chest Hospital, China. He published articles and abstracts in national journals and presented papers in national conferences. He is focused mainly on radio frequency ablation for complex arrhythmias, device implantations, and sudden cardiac arrest prevention. Presently, he is heading the cardiology arrhythmia program in Apollo Main Hospital, Chennai. Over to Dr. Karthik Easton.
The topic today, I'm going to present next 30 to 40 minutes, management of cardiac arrhythmia in clinical practice.
Cardiac arrhythmia is not very unusual or uncommon for the every practicing physician would come across. One or another day you would come across, irrespective of the practicing specialty, come across some patients with arrhythmic problem. So it's important for every one of us to get updated what is the current strategies we are following in the management, what the best treatment patient can get. Apart from the emergency management, for long term, how they can be managed. So, I would like to focus what is our role as electrophysiologist. Then we'll discuss about arrhythmia management in following headings like tachyarrhythmia, bradyarrhythmia, sudden cardiac arrest, and syncope, all related to arrhythmic problem. I'm not going to discuss any theoretical point. All I'm going to present are the case-based things, so it's easy to understand and it'll be more interesting also. So who we are? We are basically interventional cardiologists further trained in arrhythmia management. So we are called electrophysiologists. We concentrate mainly on arrhythmia evaluation, clinical as well as invasive treatment. We do mainly electrophysiology study and radio frequency ablation, which I will highlight what is that. And also our major work is pacemaker implantation and device like higher end shocking devices, CRTs, and follow the patients and troubleshooting if there is any problem. We are specifically trained in that. And risk stratification for any sudden cardiac arrest survivors or those who are likely to die, those who have the high risk factors for sudden cardiac arrest, how one should risk stratify them, how we should guide them for prevention of sudden cardiac arrest. Of course, syncope, every one of us will come across patients like syncope, which needs battery of investigation and interpretation to treat the patient. So we'll go to, you know, arrhythmia is a cardiac rhythm disturbance. The tachyarrhythmia is anything fast heartbeat more than 100. It's called tachyarrhythmia, which may be regular or it can be irregular. So we are all aware how it is classified. It's broadly classified into supraventricular or ventricular. Anything below AV junction is called ventricular, above is supraventricular. So there are so many varieties like AV nodal re-entry tachycardia, atrioventricular re-entry tachycardia, focal tachycardia, flutter fibrillation. In ventricular, of course, we all know life-threatening things, ventricular tachycardias and ventricular fibrillation. It's a broad classification with the common arrhythmias. How they present to us, these patients? When you are sitting in a clinic, these patients come to you with palpitation. Doctor, I am getting on and off palpitation. It comes and goes, or sometimes it continues for minutes, hours, or sometimes days. So it depends upon the tolerability of the patient and their symptomatic status. Somebody, even they may not tolerate it within a minute also, some patient can tolerate it days also. But they complain palpitation, sudden increase. And sometimes vaguely they say some chest pain. On detailed elaborate history, they said it's like not exactly chest pain, some heartbeat, I am feeling some unusual sensation. And fatigue, when there is a fast heartbeat, patient feels terribly fatigued, not able to concentrate any work, he has to take rest or he has to go to the hospital or he has to take rest till the arrhythmia subsides. And breathing difficulty. When there is a fast heartbeat, especially elderly patient, diastolic dysfunction, they get some breathing difficulty. Of course, hemodynamically unstable tachycardia, and there is hypotension, they lead to syncope or pre-syncope. These are the ways which patients present to us. So how one should, we should, when the patient like presenting with this suspected fast heartbeat, how we can evaluate in our practice? History is very, very important. How it starts, is it related to anxiety or any emotion or it's any exercise or at rest itself it starts, how long it goes, how it stops suddenly or gradually. So if there is any post, any polyuria or anything. So we should go in detail about the history of palpitation to differentiate is it normal or abnormal. It gives a lot of important information. And clinical examination to rule out heart failure, structural heart disease, valvular heart disease, of course we should. And ECG, the basic rule for any arrhythmia. Even the patient is, when you are seeing at clinic, having palpitation or not, baseline ECG, it's very, very important to rule out any baseline abnormality like pre-excitation, which we'll discuss. Or the patient present to you in the emergency with palpitation, it's better to document the ECG, not only treat the patient with the monitor, just first document if the patient is hemodynamically stable, first document the tachycardia, what it is, not only the ECG, then if you get, then you treat the patient. So echo to rule out structural heart disease and LV function is always we do for all patients. And thyroid profile is a simple investigation to rule out hyperthyroidism, which is not a rare thing, which we commonly present with the various set of arrhythmias. So is a treatable view. Primarily, unless you take care of the thyroid problem, the arrhythmia is not going to subside. So we always we do one thyroid profile for any patients complaining of this tachyarrhythmia. And of course, the patient comes and goes, arrhythmia, if you are not able to document by totally ECG, you can put a Holter recording, which records for 24 hours. But the problem is, unless the tachycardia comes very frequently, then only you can pick up in the Holter. If it comes once in a while, then on particular day when you are connected to the Holter, the patient doesn't get palpitation, then the Holter is going to show normal only most of the time. So it doesn't rule out it's any problem. So if it picks up, it's good. Otherwise, you have to go by history only. Then of course next electrophysiology study. So those who are not aware of what is electrophysiology study, what we do basically is we put multiple catheters inside the heart. So one the catheter comes from intraventricular vein, goes to the coronary sinus. You know the coronary sinus runs outside the mitral annulus, which is separating the left atrium and left ventricle. So this what is we are doing black thing is our electrodes. It picks up signal from the intracardiac signal is called electrograms. So this it gives 10 ports decapolar catheter, it gives left atrial and left ventricular signal. And this catheter is in the right atrium and right ventricle gives right atrium and right ventricular signal. And the impulse pass from the right atrium to ventricle, the junction, AV junction is bundle catheter. So practically we are getting information from the right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium and left ventricle and the junction. So we get information from all the channels. So it gives us an idea how the impulse is conducted and it's going. And we can perform stimulation and so many protocols to evaluate arrhythmia. So go to the example. This is one such man. He's presented us with a COPD patient. Recurrent episodes of palpitation. One such episode, we documented the ECG like this. He was already put on medications, not responded to any medications. He presented with this is the ECG. Is there any clue? It's a very common arrhythmia which you will see in your practice. there is a tachycardia, heart rate around 173. It's very irregular, narrow QRS complex. But you are not able to see any P wave. So there is no clear cut P wave. It's a very fast tachycardia. Patient was very hemodynamically stable. Only thing is he could not tolerate. He has to take rest. It doesn't stop. He has to go to the hospital, take some medication to stop that. So this is the way the many common arrhythmia, this is one of the common arrhythmia present to you. So what treatment you can give this? What is this? This is a common arrhythmia called AV nodal re-entry tachycardia. The most common in adults, up to 60% regular tachycardia. In females, it's a re-entry circuit runs around the AV node. It's a very small area. There is a two pathways, one is fast pathway and there is a slow pathway. When the impulse from the SA node to reach the ventricle, it goes through the AV node. It has a two pathways in some 30 to 40% of the patients. It has one with this form sometimes re-entry circuit, and the impulse gets blocked. It goes to the small slow pathway, comes back, and starts circuiting around that from the re-entry circuit. Suddenly, patient gets 180, 190, 200 heart rate, start getting palpitation. So, because it is a very strong circuit, both atria and ventricular activated simultaneously, you won't see the P wave. Oh, the P wave is merged inside the QRS complex in 2/3 of the patient. In 1/3 of the patient, it may be present just at the end of the QRS complex. So this is a common arrhythmia you get. What treatment you can give when you see this sort of patients in your practice? You can give vagal maneuvers like carotid massage or splashing the cold water if they can try to terminate. But it works only in 1/3 of the cases. Other patients, you can give beta blockers, adenosine or calcium channel blockers in the emergency. We can terminate the tachycardia. But what is the long-term treatment? You have terminated sinus rhythm, but the patient gets recurrent episodes again and again. You can put them on calcium channel blockers like calaptin or diltiazem or beta blocker metoprolol for long-term. But thing is, it works only for 50% of the patient. Even if it works, also patient has to take for a long period of time or like long also. So, and 50% of the patient gets recurrence in spite of good bit of medications. So, what is the alternative treatment available for us? So, this is the way we do EP study. We have taken this patient for electrophysiology study. This is how it looks. So, with the ECG, it's called multiple catheters. The right atrial signal is the left atrial coronary sinus, CS coronary sinus signal gives both the atrial ventricle and the right ventricle signal. And there is a junction is bundle, atria, is and the ventricle. We give the signal. So, all the re-entry arrhythmias we can induce by pacing the atrium. So irreproducibly inducible and reproducibly terminated all the arrhythmias, re-entry, especially re-entry arrhythmias. So this is how the tachycardia is running. The electrograms are changing intracardiac electrograms. So you can identify, this gives us an idea where it is coming from, what is the mechanism. So we can terminate this tachycardia also by pacing maneuvers. So what is alternative treatment? So we go for radio frequency catheter ablation. What it is? It's a form of alternating current we deliver to the tip of the catheter, wherever the focus, where it is originating after we localize from the EP study, we deliver the, put a special catheter, ablation catheter, we'll deliver the radio frequency energy, which is the alternative current is delivered. It destroys the local area, just 2 to 3 millimeter area it destroys. So it forms a tiny scar in that area. So it's incapable of producing or conducting any electrical impulse, it's a practically a scar. Forms a small scar in that area. You have to heat that area around 50 degrees Celsius, so it forms a scar. So there is no long-term side effects of that scar. It's a very small scar is created here. So the basic focus is to destroy the arrhythmogenic tissue by heating them barely the temperature beyond 50 degrees. So the area is destroyed. Suppose in the previous case I told there are two pathways, fast pathway and slow pathway. There is no need for two pathways for human beings. There is slow pathway, we can destroy the slow pathway. So the fast pathway continues to function normally. So by eliminating the unnecessary pathway, we are curing that almost that arrhythmia. So the re-entry form, the success rate almost 98% of the long-term recurrence less than 1%, 2 to 2%. The complication is less than 1%. So the patient gets rid of this arrhythmia practically, and there is no need to take lifelong medical treatment. So this is how we do. We put the special catheter. There is a way map that area where is the slow pathway is located and deliver the energy. We'll destroy that area. So then this patient is, then we will try to stimulate, if we are success, then tachycardia should not be inducible. So the patient goes home without any medication. So this is another patient, is a dilated cardiomyopathy with LV dysfunction. This is presented to the emergency with this tachycardia. We all know this LV morphology tachycardia, white QRS tachycardia. So the emergency doctor thought, if the patient is having already LV dysfunction, he is taking all sort of medications, beta blockers, ACE inhibitors and statins for routine medication for LV dysfunction. In spite of that, he developed this arrhythmia. So he thought it's a white QRS tachycardia, he just given amiodarone. It responded, reverted to sinus. He put the patient on long-term amiodarone. So the cardiologist, treating cardiologist also accepted that in diagnosis, he put the patient on long-term amiodarone, which we all know it has a lot of side effects, especially thyroid, liver, lung, toxicity. So after 1 year, patient developed thyroid problem. So the endocrinologist told, stop this drug, don't continue. Once the drug was stopped, patient getting recurrent episodes, then referred to us. It was practically the same tachycardia which showed previously, AVNR.